stage?
To share my knowledge with all you people. I would be speaking on CANVAS program and how it makes difference on cardio-diabetes, in fact, cardio-renal benefits. Now, recently, you must be knowing for last almost 2 years, there is a new addition, SGLT2 inhibitors are there. And these molecules have really changed the paradigm of management of type 2 diabetes. They have changed our clinical practice. They have so many advantages. If we select our patients properly, then I'm sure these molecules would be doing a wonder in the management of type 2 diabetes. Now, the basic difference between SGLT2 inhibitors and other OADs is that most of the anti-diabetic agents, they act through insulin, either releasing insulin from beta cells or improving insulin sensitivity. But SGLT2 inhibitors, there is an insulin-independent mechanism. It is not dependent on insulin. So that means these agents can be used right from the stage 1 to the last stage of diabetes. Any stage of diabetes, you can use SGLT2 inhibitors. And the main mechanism is excretion of glucose, excess excretion of glucose in the urine, leading to calorie loss, leading to weight loss, normalization of glucose, improvement in insulin sensitivity, and so many other cardiorenal benefits. So straight away coming to CANVAS program, which is with the canagliflozin, and the results were declared last year, and this trial was present in ADA 2017. It is the largest trial till date on SGLT2 inhibitors. In a way, there are almost 10,142 patients. The other trial which has been completed on SGLT2 is EMPA-REG, which was completed in 2015. So basically, this is the largest trial, and other difference is that here two categories of patients were there. One was patients with established cardiovascular disease, and other one was with cardiovascular risk factors. 66% of the patients were having established cardiovascular disease, and 34% patients were having only cardiovascular risk factors. That means a garden variety of type 2 diabetic patients who come to us. They have only cardiovascular risk factors, they don't have established CVD. Now, the important parameters and important results were that primary MACE, major adverse cardiovascular event outcome, it was significantly decreased. There was a reduction of 14% in primary MACE, we can see here. And otherwise, there was 33% reduction in hospitalization due to heart failure and 22% reduction in cardiovascular death. Although this did not achieve significance, but it was 22%. Now, in this, just a moment. Yeah. Plus, there was improvement in composite renal endpoints by 40%. So that's, again, it was a dedicated cardio CANVAS R trial where there was a 40% composite. That means reduction in eGFR by 40%. There was a regression of this and renal replacement treatment plus renal death. All these three parameters, there was reduction by almost 40%. So this is, again, very, very important. Now, effect of canagliflozin on progression and regression of albuminuria, we see it prevented the progression of albuminuria from normo to micro, and it also induced regression of albuminuria from macro to micro to normal, and it prevented progression from normo to micro to macro. So there was reduction in progression and induction of regression in albuminuria, which was very, very important because there are hardly any anti-diabetic agents which reduce albuminuria. Now, there was another important thing was that there was blood pressure reduction in systolic blood pressure by almost 4 to 6 millimeter of mercury compared to the standard arm. And weight loss was also significant, and it was around 2 kg net between the placebo, the standard arm, and the treatment arm. And this weight loss was mainly fat weight loss. 70% of this weight loss was fat. Only 30% was lean body mass. So this is another important factor, because type 2 diabetic patients, mostly they have visceral obesity, even if they are not having overweight, but they have visceral central obesity. So reduction of fat and mainly visceral fat was again a very, very significant finding. And SGLT2 inhibitors, they do not only reduce like glucose levels, there are multiple pleiotropic effects on lipids, on blood pressure, I have told you, even on arterial stiffness, the decreased sympathetic tone, decreased heart rate, and decreased oxygen demand. So improvement in salvaging kidney as well as my heart. Then there was reduction in uric acid also. So basically, typical Indian phenotype where there's a central obesity, high visceral fat, dyslipidemia, hypertension, these molecules are very, very important. And Indians as such are at a high risk of cardiovascular disease, and it is in a severe form. It is not only there's more prevalence, but it is very severe also. And even incidence and prevalence of CKD is also very high in Indian population. And again, it is in very severe form. So if we have any anti-diabetic agents, which not only controls glucose levels, also improves weight, means reduction of weight, controls blood pressure, and also is cardiorenal friendly, means cardiorenal protective, is very, very important. Now, adverse effects were also seen. It's not that no agent is without any adverse effects. And they are, as usual, in the form of genitourinary infection, volume depletion, there may be postural hypotension. And although there was no increase in hypoglycemia, acute kidney injury is very, very rare. And even incidence of cancer and pancreatitis was parallel to a placebo. Now, other adverse events which people generally talk about, that canagliflozin CANVAS program had shown more amputations. Yes, it is there. It was 6.3 versus 3.4 in 1,000 patients. It was, the ratio was 1.97, and history of amputation and peripheral vascular disease, yes, it was more, but overall we cannot say whether it is not there with the SGLT2 inhibitors. EMPA-REG trial did not show increased amputation because it was not systematically captured. So it was not one of the adverse events captured in EMPA-REG trial. So we cannot say. EMA, European Medical Agency, has put a label for all SGLT2 inhibitors as far as amputation is there. Very simple, for all. So they are not really, and like this I've already told you, that EMA has put label for all SGLT2 inhibitors. So patients who are at a risk of peripheral artery disease or have PVD, we should not be giving SGLT2 inhibitors. Canagliflozin also has other important things. One, it reduces NT-proBNP, which is a marker for congestive heart failure. Then it also reduces HS-troponin I, which is important for myocardial health. So these are also, you know, studies which show that canagliflozin is cardio-friendly, and there was also reduction in one of the trial in epicardial fat. So this is, again, important thing. Now, other thing is that on continuous glucose monitoring, canagliflozin, it improves mean amplitude of glycemic excursion, that it intraday glycemic variability, which is, again, very important. If two patients have the same A1C and one has more variability, will have more cardiovascular risk and disease in the future. So this also reduced with canagliflozin. So let's see, you know, I would like to just a couple of more minutes on CANVAS versus EMPA-REG, which is very, very important because, generally I will put the truth, you know, like in CANVAS program, there were 10,142 patients, EMPA-REG it was 7,000. It was a 6-year duration, CANVAS it is almost 4 years. In fact, it is 3.2 years or so. And duration of diabetes here, it was in CANVAS more severe, means 13.5 years of diabetic patients were there, and here it was even up to 5 years or even less than 5 years of patients were there. Now, other important thing is in EMPA-REG, all the patients had established cardiovascular disease, while in CANVAS program, 66% patients have cardiovascular disease, while 34% had only cardiovascular disease risk factors. Simple. So it was a combined population, what we have in our clinics. We have all kinds of patients with cardiovascular risk as well as established CVD. So basically we see EMPA-REG applicability is only for diabetic patients who are having established cardiovascular disease, while CANVAS program applicability is for diabetic patients who have established cardiovascular disease as well as cardiovascular risk factors. Now, this is a very, very important slide. I think you must all concentrate on this. Major adverse cardiovascular effects were decreased equally in both. 0.86 point hazard ratio 0.86, like by 14%. Now, cardiovascular death, it was reduced by 38% in EMPA-REG, and there was 22% in CANVAS, because there were more, you know, patients also with cardiovascular risk. They were not having, all of them were not having established CVD. Then non-fatal MI, almost the same. Non-fatal stroke, it was 0.9 in CANVAS program, and it was, there was an increase in non-fatal stroke in EMPA-REG with empagliflozin, although it was not significant, like neither of the two. But important point to be emphasized is that if we see all cardiac parameters are reducing, means they are consistent, the findings are consistent, while here if we see that MACE is equal, but non-fatal MI is okay, it's reduction, but stroke, there was an increase. So how come this reduction in cardiovascular death was there is very difficult, whether it was only a statistical jugglery or it was some other parameters or some other effect which only empagliflozin has and not canagliflozin. So that is only one possibility which is yet to be seen, yet to be seen. Now, this is again very, very important. Now, CANVAS program, there was reduction in cardiovascular death by 78%, and it was 38% in CANVAS trial. But another important thing is, in the treatment arm in both, in CANVAS arm, it was 11.6 per thousand, and in EMPA-REG, it was 12.4. The arm which was intervention arm, it was more mortality, more cardiovascular death in empagliflozin. The difference was that in the standard arm, in CANVAS program, there were less mortality, and in standard arm with empagliflozin, there were more mortality. So there's one possibility that the standard arm in canagliflozin CANVAS program, that there were some agents which caused more mortality instead of empagliflozin benefiting cardiovascular mortality. Try to understand. So maybe because both the populations are different, patient group is different, so maybe it was higher mortality in standard arm in empagliflozin which pushed this cardiovascular mortality on a higher side. So this is another thing. Now, other important thing is that MACE is 0.86 in both, but if we see, go a little more critically inside, if we see 95% confidence interval, it is 97% here and it is 0.99 here. Means this reduction in MACE is more significant. P-value is 0.02 and it is almost double. So even if there is same reduction in MACE, but it is more robust, and this is despite of the fact that canagliflozin was used not only in the patients who were having established cardiovascular disease, but also patients who were at a lower risk of cardiovascular disease. Means they were having only cardiovascular risk factors. So these are important things which are still unknown, and we have to, you know, wait for maybe declare TIMI 58 with dapagliflozin, which is going to be released this year or maybe early, you know, quarter next year. So till that time, like, these questions would always remain. The other important thing in EMPA-REG was the silent myocardial infarction was also not included, and non-accessible death. There were almost 50% non-accessible death which were included in cardiovascular death. They were not, the cause was not known. We don't know, but they were included in cardiovascular mortality. So this is another, you know, a flaw in that trial. So coming to this again, that, you know, if we see, if we include this non-accessible death also, then you see this value from MACE 0.86, it goes down to 0.90. And if we include silent MI also, it goes up to 0.92. It becomes non-inferior. Not superior, it becomes non-inferior. So if these two entities, non-accessible and silent MI, are included, which were not included in the trial, then it becomes non-inferior, empagliflozin. Then coming to renal outcomes in CANVAS, it was a dedicated CANVAS R where there was a 40% reduction in renal outcomes While in EMPA-REG, it was there, but it was a retrospective analysis. It was not pre-specified. It was not there in the trial, a part of the trial. When the trial was completed, then they retrospectively analyzed that there was reduction in renal parameters. So such trials, the authenticity is not etch-merge-etch, the trials where it is a pre-specified. Now, besides these cardiorenal benefits, I've told you there was reduction in cardiovascular mortality, the reduction in MACE, major adverse cardiovascular events, decrease hospitalization due to heart failure, and renal benefits in the form of reduction in albuminuria and less requirement of renal replacement treatment. The other benefits are also there, that there was reduction in weight, reduction in blood pressure. So there's so many benefits, and these molecules can be given to all type 2 diabetic patients. There are two, three things you have to keep in mind. One is there should not be any active urinary tract infection. That's one. EGFR has to be more than 45. That's second. Third, patient should not be having insulinopenia. Like patient when they come in sepsis, when there's a lot of, you know, insulin requirement is there, the chances of ketoacidosis are more. So patient should not be in sepsis, patient should not be in insulinopenia. And if you use these molecules in a select population, I'm sure the results are very, very good. So the take-home message from my talk is that CANVAS program, which was till date is the largest program for almost 6 years with canagliflozin, there was reduction in major adverse cardiovascular events. Consistency in cardiovascular outcome means everything was on a reduction side, MACE, cardiovascular mortality, stroke, MI. Amputation, yes, it was found to be more, but since it was not captured in EMPA-REG, we cannot say whether it is not there with empagliflozin. Dapagliflozin, the results are yet to come. So then only we would know whether it is a class effect or it is only molecule specific. SGLT2 as a whole, we have three molecules available, Cana, Dapa, and empagliflozin. They are very good molecules for overweight type 2 diabetics. I think 2/3, 70% of type 2 are overweight already. And patients type 2 who have cardiovascular disease, patients who have cardiovascular risk factors, at least from CANVAS we can say. Then patients who are having congestive heart failure. Now this is very, very important. Type 2 diabetic patients, congestive heart failure, these are the choice of agents. But even if patient is having heart failure and not even type 2, the trials are still undergoing that can we prevent heart failure in future in non-diabetic patients with heart failure. Then patients who have diabetic kidney disease, but EGFR should be more than 45. There also these agents are very good. So they're best suited agents for Indian phenotype, who have central obesity, who have other comorbid conditions like dyslipidemia, hypertension, cardiovascular disease, and diabetic kidney disease. So with this, I end my talk, and I convey my thanks to all of you.
Thank you, sir, for the wonderfully explaining the two trials, EMPA-REG and CANVAS trial. Now, I think the topic is open for discussion. Any comments or questions?
See, again, you know, these questions are yet to be answered. We don't know. Because two trials, when they're different populations, different age groups, different duration of diabetes, one population, they're only established CVD, other population, we have a mix of CVD risk and this thing. So there would be some difference. But I personally feel that all the SGLT2 inhibitors are almost same, because the main mechanism is osmotic diuresis. When the main mechanism of action is osmotic diuresis, we don't know. I mean, we cannot say one causing, because amputation was more, but it was not systematically captured. If you go through the EMPA-REG trial, I've gone through it, the adverse effects, the list was only 8 to 10, while in CANVAS, the list of adverse event, including even cancer, malignancy, around 20 or 22. So these adverse events were not captured there. That is why European Medical Agency has put label for all SGLT2 inhibitors. The other thing maybe, in US, like FDA has put this label on this, because in US, canagliflozin is a molecule which is, has been used. So whenever you use, you use a molecule more oftenly, the side effects also would be more oftenly, because there I think empagliflozin is not available, and DEPA is also used very less frequently. So these are certain things, and presently they are physiological and imaging studies are undergoing, which will prove their actual effects, like superfuel mechanism, the effect of this superfuel on heart during SGLT2 treatment. Then there's another thing is sodium hydrogen exchanger. So there are a number of mechanisms which are only hypothesis as of today. So I think declared TIMI 58, which is again a very big trial, 17,000 patients there, 17,000, and I think five years trial. So that will answer all these things.
Wonderful.
Nice deliberation, Dr. Mittal, we all enjoyed it. But important thing what I want to know that whenever we get something very good in the trial, it's all appreciated. But wherever there is something which is a little bit, seems to be fishy, our eyes are always stopped there. So do you think that this increase in the amputation risk, result of the CANVAS trial, is class effect of the SGLT2 inhibitor and it has not been picked up in the EMPA-REG or in other trials because of they have not been planned accordingly, or not they have not so well planned
they
or
have not captured,
captured as a CANVAS has captured, or it is only a molecule specific one. And second part, does osmotic diuresis has anything to do with that?
Yes. Now, in the past, if you see the cardiovascular trials, because like most of the trials in the past were used to be only, you know, for hypertension, CVD. Diabetes only 2008 onwards, we've been having so many trials. So all the trials where diuretics were used, especially hydrochlorothiazide type of diuretics, they were having more osteoporosis and more fracture. That was one. This is related to a fracture. Related to amputation, like this is related to fracture only. Related to amputation, there are a couple of possibilities. I think overall it is a class effect. That is why EMA has put warning for all three. Even if it is not a class effect, there's only one possibility which we have yet to prove. That is, canagliflozin is both SGLT1 and SGLT2 receptor blocker. And EMPA is only predominantly SGLT2. Okay. So unless until we prove that SGLT2 receptors are there in the leg, peripheral artery disease, and blocking these molecules precipitate peripheral artery disease and amputation. That is only one theoretical possibility which can differentiate it is a molecule versus a class specific. Otherwise, there's no other mechanisms. All other mechanisms are same for all.
Until unless we do not get the similar observations with the other SGLT2 inhibitor,
exactly.
It is very difficult to say that they are also the culprit with this canagliflozin.
No, I'm not saying that. As of today, it is canagliflozin. EMPA, it has not been captured systematically. DEPA, the results are awaited. So once we have those results with us, then we can say. But what I want to convey that the main mechanism remains the same for all. Even the glycemic effect, other effects also remain the same. So there might be some difference in adverse events. I agree with you.
Very well put. One more observation. Now, in all, whenever we give diuretics, as you have put, or we put osmotic diuresis, now, is there a possibility that unrestricted fluid access might have contributed to dehydration and might have precipitated an event in a what we call as a already narrowed arteries or already narrowed vessels? About dehydration, because one of the things what people notice initially when they started, when you start this medicine, the first few days are the people just, they pee a lot. So does that lead to some hyper concentration,
hemoconcentration,
hemoconcentration, increased viscosity, and maybe possible platelet activation, which may contribute to the increased risk of strokes or PVD. Now, in that case, it would have happened earlier, but it can happen late as well. Or people who have had unrestored, they were fasting, or for whatever reason, they did not have restricted fluids. Now, I think that should be something they should also look into.
So there are many possibilities. You're right, absolutely. But the thing is, then it should have happened in both. The problem is why it is happening in one and not the other one. So what we can say is, I think all SGLT2 inhibitors to a large extent are same. Maybe empagliflozin was unlucky as far as kind of stroke was concerned. And canagliflozin was unlucky as far as amputation.
Maybe.
Very difficult.
Exposed to hot climates.
Very difficult. But in empagliflozin, one thing is there, if we again sub-analyze critically, that there was more amputation in the arm in ladies when they retrospectively analyzed and patients who were on diuretics in empagliflozin.
So again,
pointing towards the same kind of this thing, it is basically diuretic effect which is leading to all this. So when in EMPA with diuretics, it was more, they have not analyzed the canagliflozin. But effect is same. And in the past also, it has been seen that patients who have, on diuretics have more this thing.
So possibly should we advise them for increased water intake whenever you're starting?
Exactly. So that is there, but that's not the only thing. That's not the only thing for amputation. The PAD has to increase.
Yes.
The peripheral artery, more of, so this.
Platelet activation.
Yes. So, but I think as of today, what we should, the take-home message should be, that if we suspect peripheral artery disease by doing, I don't know whether we are doing, because this is a very simple thing, ankle brachial index, I don't think we are doing. It's only when patient comes with some symptoms, we do color Doppler to prove. Before that, we don't know. Or patient has come for amputation, there's a gangrene. That is what is happening. If we start doing this ABI, which is a clinical, only in the clinic we can do, then if there's a PAD, if you think there's a peripheral artery disease, we should not give any SGLT2 inhibitor. I think so.
Yeah, I think
because it has not been,
yes,
we are unnecessarily.
I think you put it very well, sir.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.